Good evening and welcome to the DBS News World. I am your presenter, Alex Bousquet. The St. Lucia government has signed on to an agreement that will see it borrowing $15 million from the World Bank for an OECS competitiveness project. The project brings St. Lucia, Grenada, St. Vincent and the Grenadines together and is designed to make it easier for visitors to travel between the said countries. Don Nicholas reports.
Tourism Minister Dominic Fadey says government is making headway into implementing a border control system in St. Lucia. Under the new system, there will only be one point of entry. Marine police, as well as immigration and agriculture departments, will be merged. The purpose is to facilitate the ease of travel. Government hopes to unveil the plan very soon. Additionally, local authorities have just signed on to an agreement to borrow $15 million from the World Bank as part of an OECS competitive project. The project encompasses three islands, St. Lucia, St. Vincent and the Grenadines, and Grenada. Officials hope that the pilot project, which aims to help hoteliers to become more competitive, will set the precedent for future travel in the sub-region.
As we also ponder upon the OECS competitive project, which we've just signed off and borrowed the money from the World Bank, $15 million. And this project entails three islands. So we've got St. Lucia, St. Vincent, and Grenada. And what we're doing is a pilot project that hopefully will be the future of travel in the Caribbean. What it does importantly is it enhances the ease of travel for people going between the islands.
The project also hopes to see a significant reduction in travel taxes, which in the past has placed the hotel industry at a disadvantage. It comes at a time when the cost of travel between the islands has skyrocketed.
What that does is it gives hoteliers a disadvantage in promoting themselves as multiple destinations, and it makes the cruise lines a lot more competitive than you are. And so this project allows for hoteliers that have sister properties or strategic alliances with other companies across the Caribbean to be able to have an international customer to arrive at one destination and then go to the other as if they are in the same country.
This framework is expected to provide for easier travel between the three OECS countries. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
Member of Parliament for Soufre Fort Saint-Jacques, the Honorable Harold Stanislas, has been appointed to serve as Minister in the Ministry of Agriculture, Fisheries, Physical Planning, Natural Resources and Cooperatives, with effect from August 21st, 2017. Minister Stanislas has previously served as a minister in the Ministry of Economic Development, Housing, Urban Renewal, Transport and Civil Aviation. Following his recent appointment, Minister Stanislas thanked all the staff at his previous ministry for their support. Prime Minister Honorable Alan Chastney, in explaining the decision to reassign the minister, noted, Minister Stanislas has proven himself to be a dedicated and hard worker on the part of the people of St. Lucia, and this particular ministry he has been assigned to is essential to the ambitious economic agenda we have set forth. We know that he will be successful in his new role. The 18th edition of the Pine Hill Fun Walk took place on Sunday, August 27th, with over 5,000 persons participating in the annual event. The activity commenced at the SAB playing field at 6:30 a.m., and most of the walkers completed the route in approximately 2.5 hours. More in this report. Just as last year, a charity element was added to the popular annual walk, with the proceedings of this year's event going to the World Pediatric Project and the St. Lucia Blind Welfare Association.
Following the walk, persons who were at the park were treated to a health fair. Compliments the Ministry of Health. There was blood sugar testing, cholesterol testing, body mass index measurement. There were also some vendors selling healthy snacks, salads, beverages, and so on. Patrons also were exposed to soca size, which is very, very interesting, I must say. And many of our brands and our partners like Swiss, Grace, Flow also had some customer engagements.
Overall, Mr. Mathurin says the event was a success as it culminated without any major hitches.
Of course, the never-ending issue of persons and medals and not doing the whole route came up, but really and truly, it's something which we can't control. And as always, we always appeal to persons. You are working for a cause. You are working for your health, and we really cannot prevent persons from joining the walk as they when they want. But really and truly, just a personal appeal to your conscience not to come for a medal if you know that you did not complete the whole route.
According to Mr. Mathre, the Pine Hill Fun Walk is not just an event, but has become a national movement. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busquet. Several police officers are undergoing training under the OECS Impact Justice Project through St. Lucia's ambassador to the OECS. The Impact Justice Project received a request from the government of St. Lucia for additional training for the 32 members of the Royal St. Lucia Police Force, which was eventually considered and granted. The workshop for the local police officers consisted of training in law of evidence, report writing, interviewing and interrogation techniques. More in this report. According to Professor Velma Newton of the Impact Justice Project, St. Lucia is the first in the OECS to receive this specific course.
We have 32 police officers from St. Lucia, most of them junior persons who, we are hoping will, as they progress through the ranks, would be able to put this training into practice. And the facilitators are two senior former police officers from the Barbados Police Force. Former Assistant Commissioner Mr. Bertie Hines, who is also Deputy Chief of the Regional Security System, and Mr. Leonard Broom, who retired as an Assistant Commissioner of Police and had a fairly distinguished area, especially in police prosecutions.
After this police training workshop here in St. Lucia, the regional director says the facilitators will then move to Dominica, Grenada, and then to Belize.
It is extremely important for police forces quite across the region, because these are basic areas in which police should be trained. Most of them would have received training at the police colleges, but, training is not static. You have to take into account new developments and you have to be refreshed from time to time. So we consider that is extremely important, and we were quite pleased to receive the request from the government of St. Lucia.
The Impact Justice Project aims to improve access to justice in the Caribbean and is funded by the government of Canada. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busquet. And now, Street Vibes. Hi, I'm Alex Busquet, and you're watching Street Vibes. Do you think we have enough agricultural activity going on here in St. Lucia to sustain ourselves?
Well, we have some activities, but it's not enough. The reason why I'm going to say that is that we have too much wasteland. And instead for the people to occupy the wasteland, they are leaving the wastelands and they all come into castries and hustling by a tree. I feel we should have more productive farmers in this country.
Personally, I don't think we have enough agriculture going on. We see a lot of the lands being, just sitting down idly. When you go down south, you see a lot of the farmers' beds, what we used to see all a long time ago. Even the greenhouses, they're deteriorating. I think we need to focus on feeding ourselves. I think that's of prime importance. Any country that can feed itself is a wealthy country. And I also think we should not take into consideration the whole GMO, because GMOs are genetically modified. They're different than what God created, which is what's supposed to heal us and give us strength and energy. But a lot of these GMOs don't have the nutrition that they claim to have, and a lot of the science and data is actually fake. So people need to focus on what we've been fed through our government agencies and the entire world, because there are countries that do not allow GMOs into their food system. So we have to focus on these things, and we should not allow ourselves to just be buying from people all the time. We should really try to focus on feeding ourselves.
Of course we have enough land, of course.
Why would you say that?
Because I see a lot of land everywhere, empty land. People not to, using it, so we have enough.
We have enough to do it.
Of course, you're just lazy.
Il signe à cette pour agriculture ça fait voilà mais c'est l'argent qui marche. Oui l'argent qui marche puis help. Si nous jouons help tout bail qui work. Moi même son femme mais pas ni help sur ma ça dit comme quoi n'ayant rien mais avec ma pas ni help. So moi qui accepte si moi qui help.
Well, at the moment, I don't think there's enough agricultural activity in ourselves, but I first believe that we have set the mindset of our people. I go to the market every Saturday morning and the producer, fresh local organic produce, stays there a whole day to sell. So even if we increase our agricultural produce, but the mindset of people must change that they will consume what we grow. But I still believe there's a lot of room for improvement for agriculture in Indonesia, more expansion of diversification of crops, and I'm optimistic that the Minister of Agriculture, who himself is an expert in agriculture, will take that venture and take us to a higher level in our agriculture production in Indonesia.
Well, there you have it. You've just been watching Street Vibes with me, Alex Buske, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Street. With that, we'll take you right back to our studio. You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We're also online and on the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, Massey Stores rewards staff and their children just in time for the new school term. And the Tourist Board says its recent market meeting was a success.
This segment is brought to you by Sagicor Finance. Sagicor Finance, wise financial thinking for life.
Massey Stores St. Lucia Limited is continuing its tradition of assisting the children of its employees to make a smooth transition from primary to secondary school. Children who excelled at this year's common entrance exams will receive financial and other support over the next 5 years as part of the company's 2017 scholarship and grants program. Here's Don Nicholas.
For the past 13 years, Massey Stores St. Lucia Limited has recognized the dedication and success of children of its team members who excel at the Common Entrance Examination. The company rewards their efforts through its scholarship and grants program. Through this initiative, the students receive support in a range of areas, including purchasing uniforms, books, and other school supplies. They also benefit from training to prepare them for secondary school. Managing Director of Massey Stores St. Lucia Limited, Martin Dovell, says this initiative also recognizes employees by celebrating their children's achievements.
We have done this for a long time. We have a long history of doing these scholarships. And I think I can safely say that it is something that we intend to continue long into the future once we're here. Right? It's a win-win because it benefits your parents, right? Because you know, as parents, you don't have to think about the financial aspect of your schooling, because that is paid for, right? And mom and dad can now just focus on helping you develop that aspect of your academic life outside of the cost.
Marketing manager Sanchi Raghi urged the students to embrace the opportunities to not only excel academically, but participate in clubs and other activities that help boost volunteerism, leadership, and self-esteem.
Academics are very important, so you have to give the time for your studies. Secondly, participation. There's Red Cross, there's peer helpers, there's sports. There's so many things that you can do apart from studying at school that will help you with your life as you get older. It will help you with your development, because when you reach secondary school, you're going through the teenage years, and the teenage years can be very daunting for you as well as parents.
Former awardee and Massey Stores intern Claire Marisa Smart says the scholarship and grants program is a truly life-changing initiative for both recipients and their families.
Continue to work hard, stay focused, and always remember to have fun while still working hard to uphold your scholarships. Take it from me as a past scholarship holder, it doesn't only help you, but it helps your parents as well save a lot of money and time. To the parents or staff members, continue to provide for your children, living by good example, and be thankful that you are part of this amazing organization, Massey Stores, for their continued support in every aspect of your life, as well as your child's life.
The 2017 awardees join an elite group of over 100 Massey scholarship and grant recipients. Company officials urge them to use the opportunity to learn, grow, contribute to their schools and community, and continue making their parents and Massey family proud. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Windward and Leeward Brewery has a long history and proven commitment to enhancing overall St. Lucian society. Through their social responsibility program and philosophy, they have made education a focal point of their efforts through their Education for Life program. This commitment was again reinforced this week as 11 children of some of the company's employees were awarded scholarships for 2017 school year. More in this report.
Windward and Leeward Brewery has always taken their philosophy of corporate social responsibility very seriously. The brewery is involved in numerous community activities and programs island-wide. A signature effort is their Education for Life program, which features awarding scholarships, buying books, and numerous other efforts that directly assist both the employees' children as well as children in various communities and schools around the island.
Our scholarship program is part of our Education for Life program, where we also purchase textbooks for over 120 employees' kids. We have an active internship program with the Sir Arthur Lewis Community College and a breakfast program working with two schools to provide breakfast for kids who are in need.
The guest speaker for the event was Mr. Pius Bastian, a 30-year veteran in the education system. In his address, he emphasized the importance of focus, hard work, and discipline, but he stressed that this be tempered with a proper balance of work, play, nutrition, and proper rest. He told the students and their parents that if they can dream it, then they can achieve their dreams.
If you can dream it, students, you can achieve it. If you can dream of becoming that pediatrician, you can achieve it. If you can dream of becoming that pilot, you can achieve it. If you can dream of becoming that teacher, you can achieve it.
According to Fayola Ferdinand, the brewery's corporate relations manager, their commitment to the youth and education are key ways that the brewery can contribute to the long-term economic development of St. Lucia.
We at WLBL recognize that the development of the youth and constant engagement in the improvement of education programs for the youth and also our employees are key ways in which we can contribute to the economic development of our country.
The ceremony concluded with the official distribution of the scholarship packages. There were 8 returning and 3 new students that received scholarships for the 2017 academic year. The WLBL conference room was filled with happy students and parents as they look forward to the start of the school year. For the DBS News World, I am Allison Dudley reporting.
As part of its back-to-school promotion, the Elks City of Castries Cooperative Credit Union donated school bags and other supplies to 12 children of members of the organization. The 12 students were selected by means of a draw. Don Nicholas has that story.
The Elks City of Castries Cooperative Credit Union gave 12 students school bags. The union also supplemented the gift with $300 worth of school supplies. Union officials could see the excitement on the faces of the students as they accepted the donations.
They were very excited about it, and the children as well. You could see it in their face so that they're ready to go back to school. So this is why we're helping our members so that life can be easier for them. And this is what the Elk City of Castries is all about, our members.
The members were selected by means of a draw. Union officials say it's the organization's way of giving back to society.
The reason is because that the credit union movement, and that's what it is all about, helping the community, helping the members. And this is something that will allow the members to benefit, because as we all know, the times are hard and we have to meet our members halfway.
Just last week, the Elks City of Castries Cooperative Credit Union made a donation to children who excelled at the 2017 Common Entrance exams. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The St. Lucia Tourist Board says its annual marketing meeting was a success. The meeting was held at the Bay Gardens Beach Resort and Spa and ended on Friday. The aim of this annual exercise by the SLTB is to appraise the tourism industry stakeholders of the island's performance in its main market and of the marketing strategy for the destination. The meeting attracted approximately 70 participants from hotels, destination management companies, and other relevant parties in the sector. The SLTB's marketing and public relations representatives from the US, UK, Canada, and Germany joined the local counterparts for the meeting and delivered presentations on their respective markets. Executive Chairperson of the SLTB, Agnes Francis, presented a performance review of the sector, including, among other areas, statistics on stayover arrivals from the major markets. This was followed by a discussion with the participants' feedback on the marketing approach for the island's niche areas of romance, health, wellness, soft adventure, yachting, diving, among others. The marketing and public relations teams from the respective markets then shared the latest market trends and analyses, as well as the strategies to be employed. There was lively discussion on how these can be as effective as possible to achieve growth for the industry. The meeting's concluding presentation was made by Transition LLC, a Manhattan-based marketing company that is working with SLTB on the rebranding of the destination. The translation team shared its ideas on brand development and how to maximize the impact of branding. Please stay tuned. When we come back, we have more news.
This segment was brought to you by Sagico Finance. Sagico Finance, wise financial thinking for life.
Richard Spalding, a member of the Winchester Rotary Club in England, raised £5,000 to help differently abled children and adults in St. Lucia. We'll learn more in this report. St. Lucia is very dear to Mr. Spalding's heart. He got married here 25 years ago and even bought a house here in 2010. He also joined the Winchester Rotary Club of Winchester in the UK and wanted to make a difference in the lives of differently abled children, especially those with cerebral palsy. He was able to raise £5,000 to support the worthy cause.
We packaged them all up together in Southampton We managed to get free shipping arranged with Geese Line on the Timor Stream, and that arrived here 2 weeks ago on the 14th of August.
So today.
And today, finally, here we've got all of the equipment released out of the port here into the Child Development Guidance Centre, ready to be handed over to the users.
Meet Kevin Jean-Baptiste. He's the recipient of a motorized wheelchair, which makes it much easier for him to move around. For him, words cannot express the depth of his gratitude.
I'm even lost for words because I'm so excited right now. Yes.
Tell us how you, what it was for you, the challenges, and what it is it's going to be now.
Well, before it was a challenge maneuvering around. Now, with this mobilized wheelchair, it will be greater for me. I can maneuver places and get myself faster. Yes. Well, I want to tell Rotary thank you for this opportunity. Of course, Mr. Chase and Miss Marian, the team that was a part of it.
The donation took place at the Child Development Center. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet. The hosting of the inaugural United Nations World Tourism Organization Global Conference on Tourism Development and Sustainability in Jamaica this November takes place at a time when tourism around the globe is outperforming growth recorded in the financial and business services, manufacturing, public services, retail and distribution, as well as transport sectors. Statistics from the World Travel and Tourism Council indicate that the sector generated US $7.6 trillion, approximately 10.2% of global GDP, and 292 million jobs in 2016, equivalent to 1 in 10 jobs in the global economy, and travel and tourism accounted for 6.6% of total global exports and almost 30% of the total global service exports. In addition, the travel and tourism industry generated $4.5 billion to GDP last year. This represents 30% of Jamaica's GDP, which is larger than the impact of every other sector in the Jamaican economy, and twice the size of the contribution made by the Jamaican banking industry. The country's tourism minister noted that it was the first time in the history of the UNWTO that the private and public sectors will be working together in collaboration with multilateral financial institutions to stage an event of this nature. The World Bank Group and the donor countries, through their specific investment agencies, will participate in panel discussions that will explore various areas of sustainability and how projects and financing can be generated for small and medium players in the global tourism sector. The conference will be held at the Montego Bay Convention Center in St. James from November 27th to 29th, 2017, and it is projected that close to 1,000 delegates from 157 countries will attend. Please stay tuned.
Good evening, welcome to the DBS Sports. We kick off with news on football. The 2017 CONCACAF Under-17 Qualifiers Group C concluded at the Darren Sammy Cricket Ground on Saturday evening, with Bermuda maintaining the 100% winning record. They thrashed Aruba 13-1 to top the group. In the second encounter, host St. Lucia had to settle for a 1-1 draw against Antigua, which earned them the second spot in Group C. In cricket, Central Castries booked their place into the finals of the St. Lucia National Cricket Association's Inter-District Under-19 competition with an 88-run win over Babono over the last weekend at the Mindu Philip Park. The scores: Central Castries 185 for 3, Nick Elibox 125 not out, Babono 97 for 9, Akim Ogis 21, Quayne Henry 20, Jaden Elibox 3 for 19, and Rhyme Joseph 3 for 22. Silly news on cricket, this time in the region. St. Lucia Stars will continue to search for their first win as they were again in the losers' row, this time against the defending champions, the Jamaica Tallawas. Batting first, the St. Lucia Stars got 172 for 8 in 20 overs. For the Stars, Shane Watson, the new captain, he top scored with 80 from 46 deliveries. Johnson Charles chipped in with 20. For Jamaica, St. Lucian Gary Mathre was the pick of the bowlers with 2 for 26. After enjoying a charmed life, benefiting from two drop chances, Jamaican captain Kumar Sangakkara led his team's charge to victory with an attacking 74 not out. We have the highlights.
Let's get straight into it, Mark Howard and Mel Jones with you. And a bit of a change at the top of the order. Cornwall came in, started well early, Mel, but didn't last too long.
Yeah, look, they needed to do something different. They put Cornwall up, got away with the boundary, but then found the safe hands of Jonathan Foo.
So that was the end of Cornwall. He was caught Foo-bowled Santoki with 7 off 8. Fletcher, the leading run scorer for St. Lucia in the tournament, has been in good touch. Struck some nice early blows. And he was joined by Shane Watson out in the middle. But eventually Fletcher had to go, caught by McCarthy for 20. And Watson started to find his best form of the tournament.
He certainly did. Samuels came out and joined him. But at one end, Watson was just really peppering the onside boundary. Samuels didn't last too long at all. Bowled by Powell for 4. Charles came out and just got one over the top of Jonathan Flew. Thought he almost had it, at least bump it back into the field of play. That was one of the simplest catches put down. 1 of 5 put down by the Tallawas.
Yeah, Watson was only on 22 at that stage. He went on to make a massive score in the end. He made 80. Skyball, Keswick Williams dancing and prancing, not able to take the catch. And this is Charles, who hit some good, long, strong balls, but eventually he was dismissed. Another good catch out in the outfield by McCarthy. But Watson continued on his merry way.
He certainly did. It was all onside play. The smile on the face, the former captain and the current captain shake hands in the middle. Just such a powerful player. Had great timing as well. Sammy got deceived by a Keswick Williams soul ball. Good catch there by Mohammed Sammy at short third.
Watson was joined out in the middle by Mayers, and Watson at this stage had hit top form. He was absolutely smoking the bowling everywhere. Then he got a slightly wider, slower one, and the catch was taken by Rodman Power. Sammy got Watson for 80. Last couple of overs. What about that from Mayers? A huge hit out over mid-wicket. One of the shots of the tournament.
Certainly was. He struck it beautifully well. But again, just pushing it wide, the Stars bowlers, and it helped them pick up those last couple of wickets. This one, well, this was the last ball of the innings, and it's going to be a wicket as well. Glenn Phillips with the flat throw.
It was the target. It was Simmons and Phillips reunited back at the top of the order. Lendl Simmons, that was like he was on the first tee. Bang, glorious 6. By gee, there was some heat, though, coming from Taylor.
Yeah, he bowled well early doors. Short ball on the ground and up the other end. Oh, the master. He just started to let loose, but it's that position at this ground, isn't it? The second one down.
And that was Shillingford, drop one. McCarthy joined him out in the middle and played very well in the end. McCarthy went on to get 36 off 32. He just played a supporting role. Another catch goes down off Sangakkara. McCarthy, such a sweet timer of the ball. But look at Sangakkara. That is vintage.
It certainly was. And I think that just released so much pressure because he had been getting starts, hadn't been carrying on. Simple catch, actually taken. A little bobble there by Marlon Samuels, but he took it. Then all of a sudden, Kumar Sangakkara says, I'm going to start to hit 360.
Yeah, he was starting to play tricks that few can do now. Look at that for a shot from Rodman. Pow! He just goes whack over mid-wicket. It looked at that one stage, these two will be there at the end. And then Rodman Power suddenly loses his batting.
On this occasion, out of the back of the hand, Kumar Sangakkara still picks it, finds the boundary, picks up a home win.
Stay tuned, more sports after the break. Welcome back to the DBS News World. It's now time for commentary.
Some time ago, someone sent me an email which related a story about a young man who sought to explain to a senior citizen why it is impossible for the older generation to understand the younger generation. According to the young man, the older generation grew up in a different world, an almost primitive world. The young people of today grew up, said he, with computers, televisions, jet planes, and space travel. They have nuclear energy, ships, cell phones, computers with light speed, and many more. To this, the senior citizen responded, "You are right, son. We did not have those things when we were young, so we invented them. Now, you arrogant little twit, what are you doing for the next generation?" I suppose that this was meant to be funny, to put the youngster in his place. But it is no joke. Remember this? Necessity is the mother of invention. What's left for them to invent? Generated power and light bulbs took us out of the dark. Water pumps and plumbing took us away from the rivers and the backyard pits. Gas and power took us from the toir wash and the coal pots, etc., etc. Modern machinery, modern technology, and artificial intelligence has made life so very easy for the youngsters of today. I wonder, did we not rob them of the opportunities for personal self-development? If you are 40 years plus, think back to your years of growing up, your years of personal development of body and mind. Remember the things that motivated us, the trials and triumphs, the wishing and wanting, the working and achieving, the effort of moving from one plateau to the next, from the lower to the higher. Remember the feeling of attainment, finally. Remember the words that pushed us. If at first you don't succeed, try, try again. And this, how high I aim, how much I see, how far I reach depends on me. We knew that we had to work hard for what we wanted. No instant nothing. But we got careless, I suppose. Since we had it rough, life had to be made easier for our children. No struggling or suffering for them. Did we do them an injustice? Did we deny them the opportunities that we had for personal growth? We are the ones who plopped them down in front of the television sets while we were busy doing God knows what, instead of teaching them how to read. We are the ones who locked them up inside and handed them video games instead of taking them outside and giving them cricket bats and footballs. We did not teach them the three R's, reading, writing, and arithmetic. That was the teacher's job. Guess what? Today's teachers don't know the three R's either. Teachers, too, grew up on the television and the computer. We did not teach the children how to play and how to win and lose. Now to play a game is to sit at the computer, no physical exertion, no human interaction. To win is to blast all your opponents to smithereens for major points. To lose is to be blasted into thin air. And then we wonder about childhood obesity and diabetes. We can't figure out why it is the children are so aggressive and why, if they are in circumstances which allow them at least a minimal chance of winning, that they would be so angry and belligerent towards each other and the rest of us. Without a doubt, they are intelligent and they are probably wired differently to us. The youngsters will turn on a computer or a phone and within an hour would master all of the features on the piece of equipment that you and I would not fathom for months of trying. But don't talk to them about good manners, etiquette, or courtesies. Those were rules of behavior that we grew up on. Those were the rules of behavior that sustained us back then. Those were the standards that our parents demanded, but these rules became old-fashioned and outdated. So instead, we allowed our children to develop their own identities, their own personalities. Self-expression, we were told, is important for their personal development. Never mind that the self-expression often embarrasses the parents. I don't believe that the spankings that we got as children are responsible for making us into the persons that we are today. But it sure as hell did not hurt us. What would have hurt us is if we had mentioned calling family services because our parents beat us. Yeah, we would have had a second beating for our hard yes. Today, spanking is considered abuse. Spare the rod, spoil the child. One would think that with all the modern machinery, modern technology, and artificial intelligence making life so very easy for the youngsters of today, that we would have beautiful, contented, well-adjusted youth growing into productive, well-balanced adults. But that is not so. Instead, we have a large population of malcontents, angry, aggressive young people with nothing to look forward to but death. And with their fast cars and the drugs and alcohol, they are working fast to meet with it. And no one seems able to stop this phenomenon. I think that the youth need to see into the future, to see that there is something beautiful to look forward to, that life is worth living, not simply for what they can get out of it, but for what they can contribute to it. But these days, it not looking so good, nah? For commentary, I am Lorraine Deborah Glass.
I now take you back to Alex with the lighter side.
And now for the lighter side. A four-year-old monkey who failed to find love at an Israel zoo has found another source of affection, adopting a chicken that wandered into her enclosure. The room at Grand Safari Park said zookeepers were initially worried when they saw the macaque monkey, Niv, holding a baby chicken that wandered into her enclosure at the park. The keepers said they removed the bird from the enclosure, but it wandered back on its own 2 days later. Niv has taken to carrying the chicken in her arms and is frequently seen hugging and grooming her adopted chicken as if it were her own child. Workers said the chicken accompanies Niv into the monkey's sleeping enclosure each night and emerges with her in the morning. They said the chicken has the ability and frequent opportunities to leave the enclosure, but willingly stays with Niv and will run to her for comfort and protection when it is frightened. Zookeepers said Niv has reached the age of sexual maturity, but has not found a partner among her fellow monkeys. Wow. This has been the DBS News World. I have been your presenter, Alex Buske, and I'm saying good night.